Welcome back, everyone. The teams are readying up on stage for our fifth match, CounterLogic Gaming versus the Flash Wolves. Doublelift, of course, deciding to make a reappearance on the desk. I'm sure he has things to say about the matchup that's about to happen. Now, in the fight to advance from Group A, this is a must-win for both teams, so let's run down the rift and look at the matchup. Starting in the top lane, the fight between Zion Spartan and Stake, and I think something that's important to note here is the CS discrepancy between the two of them. Zion Spartan, on average at 10 minutes, 9.8 up against his opposing mid laner, whereas Stake, in the hole, almost 6 CS on average.
There's like two ways of looking at it. Stake, you could say maybe he gets starved, but in reality, if you take a look at his games, it just looks like as if he's on a hunger strike. He doesn't take anything that is given to him. And speaking of eating, and in this matchup specifically, I think Zion Spartan is going to eat him alive.
Well, speaking of, by the way, Darshan, being a vegetarian, is going to have to switch his traditions and going to have some steak for lunch right now. But on a more serious note, Maple versus Pobelter. Maple is kind of the star of the Flash Wolves. He gets a lot of attention. Pobelter does not. He gets thrown under the bus and any other kind of idioms that you could say as to how little help he gets from his team. There's almost no synergy between him and Nick Smith, as he's usually just helping the duo lane out. And Pobelter, regardless, puts a lot of damage for his team. He brings so much to the table with what he gets is very impressive.
Well, this is really a very interesting matchup because of how many mismatches there are as we go down lane by lane and the very big stylistic differences between these two teams. For me, if you take a look at guys like Karsa versus Xsmithy, and sure, Xsmithy had, he improved in the playoffs, right? But I wouldn't say that Xsmithy had a good performance. I would say he had a very mediocre performance. But it was an improvement. But Karsa's a star on this team. He does about 5% more damage as opposed to when compared to the rest of this team total than Xsmithy does. He also is a guy who can play early. He can play Nidalee. He can play Lee Sin. These are champions, whereas Xsmithy spent the majority of the season sitting on Gragas, and this is going to be dangerous because Pobelter could be a real threat here with the Maple Karsa synergy.
Yep, so mismatches across the lanes, but also if we take a look at the teams and their play styles in general, stylistically, it is a mismatch. Looking at the first 15 minutes of the game, if we look at kill location between these two teams, what we'll notice is a huge priority and focus for CLG in the top lane, whereas the Flash Wolves down near the Dragon, mid and bot lane.
Well, this really just shows how much CLG likes to group, because this action in the top side is not just like Zion getting kills by himself. This is lane swaps from CLG. This is mass rotations coming into the top lane to try to take towers. CLG's bot lane being so strong, what usually happens, they take the bot lane turret, rotate into the top. The opposing team wants to defend that. They send a lot of people top, and then CLG can respond by having Xsmithy follow, by having a TP advantage, and just really outnumbering. So that's just a really good indication as to the pace that CLG likes to take of taking one tower and then quickly rotating, which is really the standard play when you take a tower advantage.
Now, looking at that jungle matchup, we've spoken to Karsa being a playmaker for the team as well as Maple. But then on the side of CLG, you know, it's usually the side lane focus is either the bot lane or Zion Spartan. Is Xsmithy going to be able to keep up with Karsa and you know, keep the pressure out of the mid lane so that his side lanes can do the work they need to do to create an advantage?
Well, you have to remember, he also plays Lee Sin. Like, Xsmithy has... he's a pretty good Lee Sin. I mean, two seasons ago. But, okay, come on.
We're reaching back.
Yeah, let's get, I mean, we're dusting the shelves here and really, like, pulling that out. But he can play Lee Sin. Like, he's not the fanciest of Lee Sins. But back then, you didn't really have to do a lot on the champion. You can just play a solid game and play him as a peeling champion as opposed to a playmaker, which is kind of the way that Karsa likes to play. But I do think that he does have the ability to play these champions in an effective way that can deal with aggressive junglers in a better fashion than the Gragas can.
Another thing I want to note here, just as a trend of the first day, the average game time so far today has been 26 minutes and 30 seconds. Incredibly fast games of League of Legends. Granted, there have been some rather lopsided ones between teams that were expected to go that way, which could be skewing the data slightly. But when you're looking at fast game times and then this matchup specifically, who is does that benefit more? Would you give it to Flash Wolves or CLG in quicker games?
I think that if we look at CLG, they're very good at the lane swap. They tend to get a few kills early. We were watching this in the finals against TSM. But CLG, even though they have these early leads, they did an actually pretty, I wouldn't say, it was pretty average, but they made some mistakes in closing out the game. So I don't know if this one's going to be as fast. And I'm holding off because what we need to see more of from CLG is effective use of their early game advantages. They get these advantages, and instead of, for example, in the finals, the Yasuo getting really far ahead and then split pushing, they started to group and follow TSM around the map and just be slightly delayed. So TSM was actually able to sort of get back in there for a while by sieging turrets and just avoiding fighting. CLG seems to be, I would say, afraid in the mid game to really drive home an advantage. And that's what I'm looking for them here. If they can do that, then I think they'll be in a good place to win this game quickly and then make it out of this group. If they continue to have these problems, I think this group is much more up in the air.
All right, well, it appears they have a slight audio issue on stage, so we have a little bit more time to talk about these teams we had originally planned. You know, so I'm going to come over to you, Yamato, because originally we spoke about this top lane. When it comes to Stake and his hunger strike, you know, if and when those CS discrepancies are fixed, is he the kind of top laner that can stack up to the likes of Zion Spartan?
It's like, it's so hard for me to see. I just doubt it. But I think Monte Cristo highlighted a good point that Zion Spartan, like, I remember back in season 4 when he was back on Dignitas, he was doing the split pushes. He was good at split pushing. But right now, when you get these advantages in the top lane, usually it is the split pushing that is going to drive you home. And as you said, we haven't seen it.
Hang on. Like, the split pushing is there, but the thing with, we looked at the resource management from CLG, and a lot of it goes to double lift. So the results that you want from Zion are not as much as you need them to be with how much pressure you're putting on him, how much help you're assisting. So he really needs to crank up the gears. I really don't know how you say that. But he really needs to buckle down and get
the gears. I'm really just saying words right now. Well, with all of these stylistic differences pointed out, everybody at home, if you don't want spoilers, mute the stream because I'm about to ask you guys once again for your predictions. Starting off with Yamato.
Counter Logic Gaming.
There it is.
CLG.
Next CLG and?
I mean, I'm not even 50% sure of the majority of things that I do. CLG can offer me a 50% chance that they are the best team in the world. That's good enough for me. CLG for this.
That actually explains a lot of your jungling.
Thank you.
There you go.
Well, that jungling directly affects your team.
Hey, we've identified the problem. If anything, we're making progress
Thanks.
Here.
We've had a breakthrough.
All right, well, there it is. As we send it out to our casters, Double Lift tells us about the Flash Wolves' reliance on the southern half of Summoner's Rift.
So we can probably expect them to play off of mid and bottom like they have in their playoff games. So yeah, I mean, when we watch them, they just normally play really tight with their jungle support, and their jungle support just roam between mid and bottom constantly. And they just kind of leave Stake to do whatever. Most of the time he's just dead. So yeah, that's kind of what UA Flash Wolves does.
And pretty classic Double Lift there.
It's time off the analysis desk has really like deteriorated his analysis, I feel, over time. It wasn't a quality piece.
Well, it wasn't too bad here. As we're going to check out the starting lineups, getting ourselves into these games. On the blue side, it is Counter Logic Gaming, the number one seed from North America. In the top, there is Zion Spartan. In the jungle, Xsmithy. Their mid, Poe Belto, AD carry, Double Lift, and support Aframu.
And then on the red side, it's obviously the Flash Wolves. Their top laner, Stake. Perhaps on Hunger side, perhaps not, who knows. Jungle Karsa, mid Maple, AD carry Kramer, he's back in. Yeah, got subbed out a while ago, but then comes back here. And support Sword Art, yeah, ready to go into game. Sword Art obviously featured in Rise of Legends as well, had a good story to tell here. They definitely want this victory because this means a lot in the group, probably playing for first place here.
Yeah, subbing Kramer back in is actually really big for these guys because NL played a lot for them recently.
Yeah.
And Kramer, you know, they picked him up. Sword Art specifically picked him out of Challenger Korean solo queue. And they've been working very closely with him to try and iron out all the communication issues and stuff like that.
Yeah, just more proficient in terms of mechanics. That's also reflected in his champion pool. His most favorable champion is Vayne. That's what he likes playing here. So that may be needed to keep Double Lift in check. And overall, the tendencies of both these teams, very interesting how they, you know, Dragon Focus, no Dragon Focus, top lane, Stake versus Zion Spartan. So many stories to tell, but first, let's head into Champ Select.
We are into Champ Select indeed, Crepo. As Counter Logic Gaming take to the draft against Flash Wolves. Blue versus Red here as bans are going by quickly. Malphite Thresh for CLG as the Flash Wolves take away Mordekaiser.
Yeah, take out the very, very easy initiation tanky champion for the top lane. If you want your top laner to just absorb, then the Malphite is one of the best picks for that because you can have an instant impact with a teleport.
Even from behind, Malphite still plays relatively well because you always at least have that, as you said, that initiation, that power to that stuff that can get the fight going. If Maple and Karsa are already ahead from the early to mid game, then maybe that's all Stakes needs to provide. But generally speaking, against CLG, you will need more than that. You will need actually sustainable laning to get through that phase or just be really good at lane swapping because CLG themselves, very good lane swapping team.
And the standard bans do continue as Gangplank banned away from Flash Wolves. Kalista, that blue side ban now as Flash Wolves' final ban is Vega for the first time in the tournament.
Fantastic ban in my opinion. I'm a big Vega fan.
Well, the thing with the Vega ban is they left up Lulu, who throughout the entire boot camp we were talking about, and Lulu's not going to get through any games.
Not so fantastic ban here from
you changed
Wolves.
Your tune, eh, Krepo? Yeah, the Lulu, and it's not only is it such a strong pick right now because of the way you can enable other champions, but it's the perfect pick for how they like to play with Poe Belter. They talked about it a bit on the analyst desk, how they don't like to give a lot of resources to Poe Belter. They give a lot of the 15 to 30 minutes CS to Double Lift instead. Poe Belter on Lulu would be a perfect fit for them.
Poe Belter gets so little resources, but does a lot with what he gets. He ranks very high in NA in terms of damage. He's ranked fourth there out of all mid laners. But in terms of what he does in terms of farm share at that stages, he's maybe 14th, including all the sub mid laners coming in. So he barely gets any scraps, but he still performs and does a lot of damage in the fights.
Just to hammer home that point and that stat that they mentioned on the analyst desk, talking about giving a lot of stuff to Double Lift, he has the highest share for any single player here at Worlds of minions killed between 15 and 30 minutes. And that's normally the stage of the game where you get to decide, oh, this is an open lane, you get to have these.
Oh, stylistic tendencies. Back to champs. Like Flash Wolves, obviously, they react with Braum and Rek'Sai. Again, generic, you have to get Braum first rotation because Aphremu is a fantastic Braum player. Even in playoffs, I think CLG was rating it as first pick worthy. Obviously, when Lulu's up, that shifts to second pick worthy because you really need to get that champion. At least gets picked up too. Strongest jungle champion on this patch almost?
I'd say strongest dive combo that I've ever seen. Alistar plus Elise, either of them can tank turret. Even if they sort of mess up the dive, they've got a lot of diving potential here on CLG's draft side.
And to touch back on that Lulu, how she enables champions very well in this meta game where we have a lot of juggernauts or just, you know, very strong top laners that can carry fight. She also plays so well into them. Any Hex, Slow, Diddle Dance can kite them in, like, not allow them to kill him because Wild Growth comes in. Her value was really high coming into this patch. Now with the changes, it's even higher. So very interesting that Flash Wolves left that open.
And you mentioned Juggernaut speeding them up. Darius has one weakness there, not able to get close enough to people to proc his Black Cleaver speed. Now they've got two options here, both the Jinx and the Darius. Poe Belter has plenty of work ahead of him.
Yeah, they have a wealth of CC on Counter-Logic Gaming overall. They have double damage threats here with addition with Lulu, who has decent base damage. And most importantly, they have two resets. So Jinx can get sped up. If Darius gets a kill, he gets a reset. So those late game team fights are going to be absolutely brutal.
Yeah. Okay. So we got really, really focused on CLG side because of the Lulu pick.
Yeah.
But for Flash Wolf side, their big star player is Maple in this mid lane. And he's on a champion on the AP Echo. This is going to be a full AP Echo. Didn't really get hurt as much by the tank Echo nerfs to him.
Yep.
So he's on a champion that can snowball. The assassin from the mid lane will see if he can pressure Poe Belter at all and get to roaming and get to trying to affect the rest of the game. Karsa's going to try and be hand in hand with him on that Rek'Sai and get that duo ahead.
And that is for me the pivotal matchup here. Not Maple against Poe Belter, but Maple and Karsa against Poe Belter, because it's not Poe Belter against Smithy. He rarely gets ganks for him. He's very laid back in his approach to farming. Very often drops CS just to stay safely in lane because he has to, because the resources from CLG just go so much towards their side lanes. So that could be very interesting if Karsa can find an opening, kill Poe Belter once. That can maybe start snowballing and then that can flow over into the side lane later on for the Flash Wolves.
And we've rounded things out with Nahtar as well. So again, sort of continuing the trend, Malphite banned away by CLG. Gonna take a somewhat low econ top laner just to be effective in the big fights.
And I just love Braum Tristana. That is, if you know where the enemy jungler is, which Karsa should be able to find out since he has the more aggressive jungler, you can actually use those gap closers offensively. Tristana can jump in for the slow, Braum can follow up, put up the unbreakable, and suddenly you can't kill the AD carry, they'll just jump on top of you. It's incredibly hard to deal with that with a low mobility AD carry like Jinx unless you get that kill for the reset. So, double lift and after
the old leapfrog technique there in the bottom lane.
And it's interesting as well, because that was a big champion for Doublelift, has been that Tristana. So he takes a Jinx here instead. As a, yeah, it's just kind of curious there. As the analyst desk are calling this game for CLG, but of course, we want to hear your predictions instead. Send that hashtag CLGWin or hashtag FWWin to at LOL Esports, and we'll check out how the fans are voting.
All right, let's waste no time and jump right into the Rift here. CLG versus Flash Wolves. This is also going to be a really big game for this group, because CLG and Flash Wolves consider to be fairly close here, battling to try and get one of the top spots.
Yep, so a pivotal first game here for both sides. The top seed from NA, CLG, will take to the Rift against the second LMS side here on Flash Wolves, but don't let that seeding placement fool you. This team is very good, and Maple, certainly the player to watch out for there.
Yeah, and a team that will definitely be watching these games, obviously the Ku Tigers. They have the most threat coming out against them for potential domination in this group from CLG, and to a second extent from Flash Wolves. So to get to see this match first is very beneficial for them.
We'll be playing next, of course, up against Pain, but we have this game to get to first, as CLG just moving themselves pretty aggressively through the top left-hand side of the jungle, trying to get those wards down.
Yeah, we were looking at the stats earlier for lane swaps. Traditionally, in LMS, we don't see that many lane swaps, but if you look at the gold values that Flash Wolves generate when they lane swap, they're actually a better lane swapping team. Comparable gains compared to CLG, but I feel like CLG does it in a tougher region because LMS isn't accustomed to lane swaps. Obviously, Flash Wolves, they get away with a lot of sketchy moves sometimes, whereas CLG, they're in a region that plays the Western lane swap, which in our opinion very often is credited as the better style. No, whether you agree or not, CLG actually thrives and actually very often comes ahead in that lane swap. So this does end up being 2v1. It could be interesting.
Yeah, and here you see CLG waiting in the fog of war, not trying to give away any information until absolutely necessary. There it is, and they're going to see the bottom lane down bottom. So coming in here to try and check those Krugs, Flash Wolves are going to end up 2v2.
And now I can see Smithy.
They're starting them very late here.
Yep, are going to team up. Those Stake and Kassa are actually, of course, double jungling, but we can see Sword Art and Kramer moved in, try to block them away. A little bit of experience there for CLG, but did not complete the camp.
Yeah, we just did a head count. We talked about champion diversity in top lane first. This is 9 different mid lane picks in 10 different games, with the only repeat actually being the Azir. So again, so many different champions coming out today.
Yeah, definitely unique champions, a big deal. But another big deal here is CLG. Yeah, they got the deep wards down and they got off the aggressive jungle start. Smithy with Zion Spartan were able to take away the red from Flash Wolves in the opening to this game for the lane swap. So CLG already off to a good start. Talked about the experience they have with lane swaps. They got so many advantages through the normal season, through lane swaps, getting not only Doublelift ahead, but also Zion Spartan CS advantage for the early game.
And that's actually really smart what they did. They moved in on the left side of the map, where you traditionally see the map divided in half. Okay, mm-hmm. We take the left side because we have this triple deep ward combo, and we use that vision to secure at least 2 quadrants of the map. Then we do whatever we want. Standard Western lane swaps plays out. But CLG, they based. They faked that lane swap. Then they went back to say, okay, Doublelift and Aphromwood, you have to move into the dark, but you're smart enough, you're good enough to handle that. In addition to that, you have then that aggressive jungle start that you just pointed out. And suddenly, CLG find themselves ahead in terms of map pressure already before the game's even started.
Yeah, especially Doublelift and Aphromwood, who are the bottom lane, who are never afraid to go into any 2v2 matchup, yeah, regardless of champion advantage or not, catching the Flash Wolves by surprise. Now, we talk about all these stylistic differences that we spent so long researching from these teams and collecting a lot of data on them. One of the biggest differences across regions was actually between these specific teams,
yep,
CounterLogic Gaming and Flash Wolves. Looking at where early game kills occurred, within the first 15 minutes, CLG actually had the least of any team as far as kills around the bottom jungle, which is generally just around the dragon,
yep,
area, and signifies a lot of fights around that dragon area. Only 9.6% of their kills on that bottom side, whereas Flash Wolves were 24.5% of their kills down there, where CLG much more top lane focused in their lane swaps, where Doublelift and Aphromwood and Smithy were getting kills up there.
And obviously Flash Wolves have done their research, as does CLG, so both know that these trends exist, both know that each other knows that the trend exists, so we may see some good old mind games here. Doublelift finally reaching 11-2, and then Aphromwood may just skill heal here for some sustain, or get ready for a combo. We haven't seen him use the heal yet. Just gonna check what he got.
Yeah, he's got plenty of sustain here, you know, with the relic as well as the option to level up heal. But no summoner or no spells necessary for him to level up yet. So
he hasn't skilled anything, so he can still go for WQ combo, or he can steal a skill a heal if he needs. So that's actually very adaptive.
Yeah, what he's waiting for right now is for Doublelift to take a bad trade. If Doublelift got hit there, then level up the heal so he can get the most out of his AoE heal. Heal both of them.
Kasa.
He's behind, and Smithy going top here.
Yep, Smithy looking for that gank onto Stake here. Cocoon not quite there as the hop will get Gnar out to safety.
Yeah, but look at the amount of range minions there. That wave is pushing away from Stake. That's going to be hard. He has the range advantage on Spartan, but obviously CLG is comfortably pushed in their bottom lane tower here. We see a repeat gank from Smithy.
Going to go back in. Flash is good from Stake as he barely misses getting apprehended.
I was actually very surprised that Smithy didn't come again from the tri-brush, because he should have taken the information he got from the first gank, seeing the reaction time of Stake, and inferred that there was no ward in there already. Yet he came around from the jungle, didn't get, you know, any range on it this time. And yes, it is just a flash trade, but Smithy stayed up there quite a while.
Well, this looks really good for CLG. It does nullify some of the advantage that CLG had. They had more jungle camps available to them due to the level 1 start, but yeah. Flash was kind of neutralized that by sending them sending their jungle into the enemy jungle. That is what Stake does, right? He
absorbs.
We often joke around it, but he is literally left alone on an island, and then the remaining part of the map has to be won by the Flash Wolves, 4 against 4.
Yeah, again though, so much focus on Smithy. He's going back a third time to pressure top, and they are really trying to earn Zion a lead. He's not on the ward, because you just go up the send here by the river. They know he doesn't have Flash. Smithy should get close for this one first.
Stake totally hasn't seen him. Cocoon will land. Apprehend. He's going to follow through. Stake just enough to hop away.
Bounce.
And no summoners left to follow.
That's 3 ganks in under 5 minions. Minions spawn and meet at 2 minutes, so that's 1 gank per minute coming at Stake.
Smithy, dismiss your spiders. They want the wave to be frozen there in front of Zion Spartan, so dismissing those spiders and getting them over to attack quicker.
See a roam from Maple coming out. This is Flash was like doing, but Doublelift and Afro are getting caught here.
Yeah, good game sense, actually. Yeah. Maybe a call from Pobelto. You never know what's going on in the comms. Could have been a call, could have been game sense, but any time they back up like that, Maple actually has to go right back to mid lane so he doesn't lose out on too many minions. Karsa did have a pretty good recovery, by the way. You mentioned going for that counter jungle, seeing Smithy up top. At least the Flash Wolves were able to get Karsa back on track at the expense of Stake. Yes, there is a huge CS discrepancy, but Karsa was able to get his red at least.
Yeah.
Or steal the red.
Might look to have a gank in the mid lane here as Maple having a bit of trouble here against Lulu. Good Glitter Lance there from Pobelto.
But yeah, that roam cost him tempo and pressure, and now Pobelto, he can just push out that lane. He's still on a lot of resources here, so if Maple is down, Karsa, we praised him for his jungling and his aggressive jungle, but he really hasn't found an opening just yet because CLG made his path very predictable. Because Zion was spending so much time in the top lane where he started, it kind of forced Maple to take that path from top right to bottom right, and then base, and then try and help Stake somehow. So he's trying to stay afloat, but he's not really finding any openings right now.
Yeah, one of the best parts of CLG's early game and of their lane swaps is how they disseminate as little information as possible in the early game. And it keeps Flash Wolves guessing for the early stages and makes you have to react very quickly as a jungler, make very quick decisions. Now, after so much pressure top, looks like Karsa's going to even the odds.
I mean, Zion Spartan did use his flash earlier, so this it kind of has to work almost, because look at that CS discrepancy right there. 26 to 47. Zion Spartan doubling Stake's farm already.
And Karsa is looking for something here, but he hasn't quite picked the angle. Zion Spartan is a little far forward in the lane. Ulti's ready for Stake. He's going to go in for it. Karsa finds a knock-up. Good wall up there as well. Can they come out all the way? There's the ulti out from Gnar. And a wonderful CC chain is maybe just getting it first blood. Yes, it is. Karsa takes it.
Poor Stake. He gets ganked 3 times on a no-flash target. Doesn't even get the kill. He's going as well. I'm going to flash, take that gold, and bring it to bot lane, guys.
Hey, Karsa earned that money. He came back after Stake had blown so much, and CLG had spent everything trying to keep him down. Flash Wolves get the first blood. They're ahead in gold now.
That almost has to be an error in communication, though. Like a flashless target stuck in the brush, zoned by 2 guys. You don't want to use your flash aggressively there if you're Karsa, especially when you can get Stake rolling and give him a kill. So hopefully he can stop bleeding out CS in the top lane. But let's see what Karsa does with this. Perhaps he just has a really aggressive Rek'Sai build plan to start becoming a split pusher later?
I never sympathize with top laners, I'm sorry. I'm glad you're here to tell their story.
They'll lose the jungler of the group. Isis Kassa does take his red buff. Mil headbutt him to spend that juicy first blood money. Po Belta hanging out in mid lane, got his chalice already going. His bottom side now double lift. BF sword up, but Tristana does have the same as Po Belta. Gonna get himself the blue buff.
Oh, we saw some aggression in the top lane. Look at the deep vision Flash Wolves have acquired in CLG's red jungle. Those are triple ward, very deep here. Afru getting zoned out, pink ward getting cleared. Both AD carries have a BF sword, so things can get explosive very quickly, especially with the deep vision they have acquired.
Smithy now gonna clear out the Scuttlecrawl.
Oh, I did!
Karsa wants to fight him for it.
So, yeah, Karsa was underground, didn't see the low health crab there, or else he would have shot the Prey Seeker and stolen it. The one small disadvantage there of Rek'Sai. Yes, you get your Tremor Sense, but can't see the crab scuttling away, and free gold goes down the drain.
Bloodlet of gold as well. Aldrich Scuttler as X-Smithy will clear this Raptor camp out for himself. He's level 6, actually, going for that Rune Glaive of the item we've seen so many times out of Elise, ever since sort of the changes moved through, as Maple gonna get his blue buff now as well. A very generous donation from Kassa.
So Stake's happy to see this because he knows exactly where X-Smithy is. He got an assist, he's playing as Darius so he can use his range advantage, and he's closing the gap in CS, at least keeping the absolute number even, so as time goes out, relatively becomes a lot easier to deal with. CLG pushing in the bottom too, so Flash Wolves are playing with a lot of information.
Yeah, it was actually, that's so smart for Flash Wolves when Smithy is obviously camping up top and Stake is spending that time, you know, trying
absorbing
to evade all of these attacks.
Absorbing.
Yeah, and he did it well. He was able to evade all of the ganks, but they spent it wisely. Yes, they counter jungled. They were able to take away the red buff. They got deep vision down, which they can now use to take this dragon. They can see any sort of approach from CLG, and Karsa is going to be able to get an objective for his team as well.
Yeah, Maple's zoning mid lane away with Fog of War because he hides in that burst, so Po Belta can't face check because Double Lift and Afremu have been continuously pushed in the bot lane. In combination with that deep vision, again, it gives the entire bot lane bottom jungle two Flash Wolves in both pressure and vision that manifests in a dragon, which they, yeah, they love doing that. So it doesn't seem they're changing up their playstyle, their trends. They want to go for those early five dragons.
It's a smart little play there to get the dragon as Maple goes in. X-Smithy forced to repel up, but Po Belta here is here in reserve. The cocoon will lank. Little Ants is good. Damage not going to be followed in.
Yeah, you have to be very careful about fully committing to that kill on Echo, obviously because of the ult, and he could burst the Smithy down afterwards. So just trying to chuck him out and then retreat. Po Belta are able to pull off the evacuation.
Done a good job in this lane as well. 10 CS ahead there, and Double Lift also having a good game. 25 CS ahead because the Afro zoning Kramer away. The rocket jump canceled as Double Lift is going to look for the zap, and the flash will get forced out.
Good punish on the roam right there. They see Sword Art leave the lane, immediately go aggressive, and they get a summoner for their troubles.
Also hard to land that combo. Alistair's W got slowed down. Many very proficient supports do fail. Okay, I'm joking. I'm the only one.
Prepo.
No, but yeah, good cancel there. Kramer had more time to flash, get out of there, but yeah, decides to use a jump. Very risky. Has to burn his flash.
And in general, the pressure starting to mount here for CLG. There's not much of a gold lead here, only 300 or 200 up for CLG, but they're continuing to push their lands and apply pressure. X-Smithy's found himself on top of a ward.
His sweeper is off cooldown as well, and he has a pink ward in inventory here.
Kassa will be able to dodge it as a result. Zion Spartan though, so I'm proxying earlier on, gonna try and take the big Krug here as well. So much topside pressure.
Yeah, but look at Po Belta, he's moving in as well. He's just adding just more aggression to that 2v2. I think they're already stronger here, Zion Spartan and X-Smithy against Stake and Kassa, but then with the potential roam from Po Belta, just so much pressure, so much zoning, and again, Stake's forced to, you know, max range CS, so no pressure at all coming out of him.
Honestly though, all props to Stake, because obviously it's a combination of Stake being able to avoid the ganks, but also
he's gotten really good at that.
And also Smithy, you know, not optimally pulling them off, but he's done very well for himself up here, only being down, you know, 15 or so. And here comes Kassa once again. He does have flash, but so does Zion. So
I mean, they saw each other in the jungle earlier, so they can obviously deduce. But yeah, Kassa is a very patient jungler. Let's see if he runs into X-Smithy. Flash Wolves do cover their grounds. They don't go for any plays that have the risk of getting backfired, of getting roamed upon here. Kassa going for, again, deep vision. They really value that deep vision this game.
Yeah, the big difference here between Kassa getting that first blood and Smithy spending so much time trying to gank top is that Kassa got the Sight Stone to work with really early, so he's getting the deep vision and he's looking for the tower dive.
Yeah, they're going in for it as well. Zion Spartan flashes out of the Umbaro though, gets out with style.
That probably was the reason we saw Carson Flasher get that early seismic, get the vision, say, well, I'll find a jungler for you at the other side of the map, Stake. You hang on there. We always joke around about how Stake always gets ganked, but he did a fantastic job surviving.
We have to watch the repercussions after this as well. I mean, Zion's got no flash. They didn't burn flashes to get that out of him either, so very dangerous. Zion intelligently backing off here, and he's going to leave that turret, even though there's a wave up there, and that's not what he would like to do.
Yeah, Sordid has roamed a little bit too much, so that bottom lane tower, you can't leave Jinx alone with a tower without any threat there for too long, because she'll get it. And once CLG opens up one tower, they are incredibly proficient at playing the map and start moving these resources around. So Flash Wills definitely want to avoid that tower from falling for as long as they can get one return gank on Zion Smart. Kill him once, then you're okay trading towers, because then you can start speeding up the game, and Stake's fine in the game again.
Yeah, I do like this pink ward that they've placed at the their own Tribush here. Because it will stay alive the entire time.
But,
oh! Aphromoo goes in for the flash combo. All Rocket Jump was already off, though. And Kramer does escape.
Yeah, just got the mini stun there, but it wasn't quite enough to get a kill. CLG, though, will get a tower in bottom lane. So starting to chug ahead a little bit more in gold now. About 1,400 up in this game.
CLG take a tower here, and 1 minute 50 seconds for Dragon. Let's see how Flash Wills are going to approach this next minute. Are they actually going to contest that? Going to do their signature playstyle where they really want to fight for these Dragons, get these skills. They have some good skirmishing available, and obviously they have a really good teamfighting support in that Braum.
Yeah, plus Stake has actually been able to complete his Black Cleaver already on the Gnar, so he's ready to join the teamfight if he can build up his Rage Bar.
Yeah, but it is tricky though. Black Cleaver is a very split push oriented build here on that Gnar. Obviously, he can't soak much damage. He can melt immediately. He can get kited incredibly easy in this teamfight, so we'll need to see a really, really good teleport from him. Other than that, Flash Wills are probably better off split pushing with him.
See, he is doing just that right now. Stake looking to apply some pressure as Zion does walk his way back to the top lane with that Phage. Stake will now go back. It seems like Flash Wills with a minute left are going to start setting up for Dragon number two for them. But CLG trying to play aggressive in the bottom side and protect the area of Sordat. Going to get the Winter's Bite down. Fighting over Pink Wars, they'll all go down.
Yeah, Maple showing himself though means you can't commit to that fight and you'll let him get away with it.
Peralta returns to the mid lane. Blue buff. Nice and fresh there out of his own jungle.
I do like this swap here from Flash Wolf, sending Tristana mid to wave clear and having Echo down bottom, letting Maple get some extra CS there with the turret down. Gonna have to be very careful about it though.
Yeah, we haven't seen that too much in the summer split because it was mostly control mages and they thrive obviously in the mid lane,
yeah,
controlling the mid lane. But if you go back to earlier when assassins were very, very meta, that's what they did. You know, you start laning the first 15 minutes, but then you put that assassin in the side lane, he becomes another split push pet, and you can really start, you know, pulling CLG's members apart. Don't let them teamfight, force them into the 1v1s, 2v2s, 1v1 on top lane, spread them out. And then if you have a good aggressive jungler, you can really exploit that, especially with the way Flash was out rewarding.
You can see some pressure now for CLG. Trying to open up the map a bit. Dragon is back, but Poe Belter and Xmithy as Cocoon will land. Damage is good there with the AP out of the Rune Glaive, but CLG can't quite knock the turret down yet.
And now that the laning phase has kind of ended and people are moving around the map a lot more, this is where Flash Wolves has failed in the past when they started Kramer because there were communication issues. Stake for a 1v1 here on Zion Spartan.
Yep, Zion does get slowed though. Stake gonna now follow it in. Have to be careful, like you mentioned already, Darius is very easy to kite. The CLG are going to look around, try and get aggressive. They do really want to open up the map so they can secure that dragon, but the vision battle is the big one here.
Yep, this time it's Sword Out who goes in deep, and he's placed an extra ward behind to see anyone coming. Gets inside of the queue.
Oh, ulti out though from Stake. Zion's going to get stunned up. Glacial Fissure out as well. Ooh. And it's so much CC as Sword Out collects it.
More revenge for Stake here. He's got a team as well. He paid his dues. He soaked all the early ganks, and now everyone's coming up to help gank Zion.
We started talking about these stylistic differences. One team very oriented on top lane, getting those skills there, and one team very oriented around that vision control and dragon, but this game completely swapped around for that second dragon there. CLG's lineup is incredibly strong if they get vision control because it's so hard to face check into them, especially when you play like these assassins and skirmishers. So Flash Wolves with a good read on the game to send their support top lane and get for the CC combo dive.
Yeah, the front line doing well is actually really important too because both of these teams have reset AD carries. So
yep,
the team fights are going to be very snowball-y when one member of the front line does go down.
Well, you can see Flash Wolves did get the kill, but did lose a dragon as CLG were able to collect their first. Infinity Edge, though, now completed for Doublelift, had the Everest Blade ticking away, but it is a big burst in power for the CLG AD carry. Now Flash Wolves going to keep themselves moving down. They're going to group up and try and knock down a turret. It's one apiece so far, but they might be able to take the early turret.
This is where I really like Braum as well for sieging, because you can see there he blocks so much of the wave clear. Now they're going to go aggressive on Afro, and they actually get his ultimate out.
Yeah, they popped it, but they can't follow in. Doublelift does get a slow. Will CLG look for the re-engage? Zion holds onto his port. They'll save it for now.
Yeah, that was an incredibly good unbreakable there from a Sword Art, just stopping that wave clear. Stake, don't fail to hop.
He's got to pick the right spot, does find it as Zion's roaming down, but he's spotted by a ward. Now CLG's turn to group in mid and try and knock down Atara, but the W out there from Maple going to get a bit aggressive onto Xmithy. They'll follow it in, Afromu, he's dived straight through there as the repel has been used. Xmithy forced to flush out, the chompers are good.
This is a bad fight for CLG. Stake needs it.
Scoops them. Zion's Spartan, though, not enough as Afro. No, ulti has to back away from the fight as well, and it's just Chaos the ulti blocked by Kassa.
That was a very, very bold re-engage from Stake. Yeah, they used a lot of cooldowns, but it was so hard. He was so far in front of his team, and he is not that tanky yet. Remember, he's building Black Cleaver.
Yeah, he was trying to throw the reset over to Kramer because they knew Afromu didn't have his ultimate steal. Now Zion has to use his flash defensively as well, and Stake comes back in with the teleport.
I'm really liking Suarez's Braum play here overall, just the way he's positioning in these fights. Earlier, when his teammates got caught, he soaked up a lot of damage there. If he wasn't in place with that Unbreakable, that could have been multiple resets and the tower for CLG. So keep your eyes on Sword Art in these fights.
Yeah, the number one thing I look for with good Braum play is offensive use of the Unbreakable. Trying to get it up very early to get your team in front and get good positioning, because then it'll come off cooldown later.
Well, Smithy is going to recall himself as we had a lot of tension in that mid lane. Flash Wolves do still find themselves up 2-1, but you can kind of tell it's only two kills. These teams are getting itchy to really fight each other and start a brawl.
Yeah, CLG's pink wards on the map have been really been lacking. That's why we see three of them in their inventory. Hopefully they can place them and start using them for vision control. They lost the vision control they had acquired earlier on that dragon. Flash Wolves moved in, took that away. They have some good defensive pink wards of their own, so honestly, quite impressed with the vision both teams have been bringing here to the table this match.
You can see CLG have swapped the dual into the top lane as well. Again, trying to equalize the tower. That one's almost a gimme as Doublelift takes it out and gets excited.
And look how Flash Wolves are distributing their resources. Sword Art is backing up Stake. They said, Stake, you're no longer playing on Isle. You've done your job. You got us here. Now you can carry.
Hey, Kramer helped also.
Yeah.
I mean, Karsa.
Yeah. Karsa, everybody's helping Stake. Everybody takes turns helping Stake against Zion Spartan.
Well, Zion actually slightly down in CS. They've done a great job getting him back into this game. You can see, oh, that's a progressive. There's Kramer. Going to go straight in for a Pobelta. Does have the charge on top, but he's popped his wild growth already. Maybe going to go for the re-engage, but
yeah, CLG collapsing first here.
That's a mind game by Kramer. Nobody would dare jumping in there alone without backup there for Pobelta. Respects him. I think if Pobelta fought him and the Jinx Walker come in, Kramer was probably just, he was probably just dead, but obviously, you have to respect the potential backup there unless you have perfect vision.
Hey, he was able to get the Lulu ultimate out of Pobelter for this fight if there is an engage here.
And this long siege causing problems, it seems, for CLG. They're trying to equalize these turrets, but the Flash Wolves are there against Stake, threatening now with the rage building up. The slow does land off the boomerang. Good repel gets him out.
And if you look at the teleports as well, Stake no teleports. Zion Spartan has it. This is why Flash Wolves are grouping. They don't want to get into a situation where Stake 1v1 Spartan, but he gets the flank off. So as long as this teleport's on cooldown, we're going to see more grouping from the Flash Wolves.
Yeah, it's a really smart move also to try and get that deep vision in, preempting any sort of Baron here and trying to keep away the blue buff from Pobelter.
Good steal as a result there as well for Maple. He does collect it. Dragon up in a minute here. Baron is alive. Both teams with fairly good Baron damage, so is a consideration in the next few minutes. And they're only getting stronger. It's been a fairly close game, honestly. 200 gold ahead, if that, up for the Flash Wolves. The COG are going to finally get the mid lane turret.
They keep on knocking, and they're finally able to take this one down. Zion also has been able to shove the wave all the way to the turret. So CLG trying to pressure two points at once. They're able to complete their objective, and they not only take the turret, but also destroy a cannon to the minion. Turret!
Taking advantage of the teleport advantage. Destroy like a lot of things as well.
Overall here, Flash Wolves have to move here to stop Science part, and then I think this is a phase where CLG is traditionally very strong. Once those three inner turrets fall off, because they're really smart when it comes to getting just a couple deep wards and start rotating around the map. We'll have to see how well Flash Wolves have adapted to that. How much practice they had against good rotating teams, because they play in Some call it underrated region, some call it just a weaker region, debatable, but CLG have a lot of experience in this exact situation where the early three towers falls, and that's where they get a lot of leads overall in the LCS.
Yeah, for the LMS, Flash Wolves do have longer than average games as well. So they have also had experience in the longer ones. We'll see if the mid game here tells a different story. No kills so far for CLG in the entire game.
So yeah, we see some items completed. We have faced an amount of completed here on Aframu. That means he's going to be building Zeke's next. And if he gets that again, we've talked about it before, how strong that item is on double lift. We have essentially a Jarrah Jinx composition that you're running here with Zeke's combined that double lift will be able to solo carry this game if it goes late. Top 40 minutes, 45 minutes into the game.
And Dragon gets taken by Flash Wolves on the other side. CLG cannot use those big items to try and force a fight. Strong objective control there from the Flash Wolves to collect their second. And it's been a real battle between these two teams. The gold lead has sprung back and forth in very small increments. And so, like we've sort of been hinting at, feels like we're building up to a very bloody and explosive mid-game.
We just see very mirrored item builds. Support's building the same thing, top lane's building the same thing. The only thing different here is the mid lane. CLG, a little early on that Baron.
Yeah, unfortunate ward there. The nooks and crannies of the Baron pit are...
Gotta sweep that. Gotta place that pink ward slightly more forward. That is very close, but sadly not seen.
Double lift and Afra gonna go back. Double lift sees some farm, does want to collect it, as he wants to do. Kramer again goes aggressive. Good cocoon though, gonna keep himself safe. But this Tristana, very itchy trigger fingers on that rocket jump.
This time you can see the rest of the team though.
Yeah.
Not as good a bluff then perhaps as Flash Wolves aren't done. They're gonna shove down mid here.
Yeah, speaking of bluffs though, COG, they're actually continuing to shove up top with double lift and Afra, with keeping pressure while just using wave clear of the Lulu in the mid lane. Meanwhile, Zion's looking for his one versus one now.
Obviously, Flash Wolves, they're afraid to really commit to that tier one tower. Yeah, they could potentially use Unbreakable to block Pobalta's wave clear, but they have no idea of how many people can be in that river because that's completely pink watered. That one ward sees the Baron, but that's all it sees, a Baron. So no vision in the river at all for Flash Wolves. And CLG, they will soon deduce that there is a ward in the pit because you could see it immediately once Flash Wolves reacted. CLG stopped that Baron. They're going at it again, the ward spots it.
Well, it has started, but they haven't seen the ward just yet. They are going to maybe just try and Zerg it down. You can see a pause, actually. Mildly awkward time, but...
Well, it gives us more time to talk about the game.
Certainly does. And a good Baron call, honestly, from CLG, but that ward may come to bite them.
No, under the assumption that there is no ward in Pitchwood is incredibly likely for CLG. That is a very unfortunate angle here on that ward. It is a fantastic call because Flash Wolves have to react immediately. And they,
yeah, or else you get it.
Yeah, and in their minds, if that area is dark, they're so scared to face check too because TLG could very well just be baiting you into that composition you really don't want to run into. So, good call by CLG. Unfortunate for them, there is a ward in the pit, so Flash was working here with my perfect information.
Yeah. All right, well, let's take a look at the team fight then because we may be seeing an actual 5v5 fairly soon here and how it will play out. Maple's completed the key item for Echo there on top of his Morellos. He now has the Zonias as well, which makes the AP Echo so much more viable. If you can get your ultimate off 4 damage with which Zonias enables, it's a huge, huge swing in his power. And they're trying to combo the AoEs here from Stake as well as Maple, with the initiation from Stake trying to chain it with Maple's own stun as well as the ultimate, and use that to get Kramer his resets.
I just got note from production too. This is actually a pause not made by any of the teams. This is actually our guys checking on the legality of that ward, just checking how that vision works out, just to make sure that there's nothing fishy going on. That's why we're checking that out. So hopefully, once that result, we can get back into the game. But so far, a lot more even game, honestly, than I had expected. I have pitched CLG first in this group, and like, perhaps even slightly underrated Flash Wolves because they've really, really showed up. Stake.
I think underrated Stake, a lot of people have.
It was almost a meme, let's face it. Like, Stake, he's on the top lane, he's going to feed, you know, food jokes coming out of the analyst desk. He gets 3 ganks against him in the first 3 minutes of actual gameplay. You know, from 2 to 5 minutes, 3 ganks against him. It only takes Karsa to come back once to punish that burn flash on Zion Spartan, and kill goes to Stake.
I do have to say, CLG could have played those ganks better as well. So it is two-part. Yeah, Stake does deserve credit, but also CLG could have played those better.
And it's so funny as well, because you look at the game now, you can see the score about 25 minutes into the game, so fairly far through it all. And those two assists the only two kills in this game. So it's all been Stake, and that's just been a lot of positioning.
I mean, it means a lot for this game because there's a distinct possibility where Stake, if he doesn't get that assist on that kill, completely alters his build path. If he falls behind and his Black Cleaver is too slow to match the tempo to the game, he very may have well built full tank, giving Zion Spartan so much more split push pressure, and then we could have seen an entirely different game. So a couple details, couple slight misplays or plays differently can really, really shape the early to mid game.
Certainly can. As you can see Stake there on your screen. That absolutely wild hair of his looking good under his headset.
Yeah, another effect also to continue on your point that it is going to have is in these team fights. Double Lift is the number one most important person on CLG. Poetter has to. We talked about.
You act like that's something new. Well, Double Lift is the most important player on CLG.
Hold on. You were like, oh yeah, they focus on top lane so much, they're going to try and get Zion ahead. There's Zion there, you know, boost Zion strategy.
Yeah. True.
Did not work out.
Secondary in rank, though, if you look at farm share. Zion Spartan gets a lot because Poe gets a little, but it is Double Lift.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, I was the one to drop the 33%.
You got the knowledge.
Anyway, it just re-emphasizes that this is the Jinx composition,
yeah.
And you need to get, and it puts a lot more pressure on Double Lift to be able to evade the AoE from Stake, from Maple.
Just Maple
in that team fight.
Maple is going to be so hard to deal with because, yeah, you can throw your traps out, but if you zone him out once, he can always come back with the ulti, and he only needs a couple of spells to one-shot you, because AP mid Echo now at the scaling has been just up on that AP damage, less base damage, does a lot of damage.
Afro has been a good bodyguard for Double Lift for a very long time, so he'll be looking for him to get some good headbutts in.
Flash Wolves learned from CLG's mistake. They placed the pink ward even deeper in the pit. They really want to see everything going on here. But yeah, the Dragon Dance has slowly been replaced by a Baron Dance. On edge here in this game.
It is, and as we pop back in, it's really been Flash Wolves just coming back and cleaning all the vision out of that Baron area that CLG have put down. So we will have a bit of a reset here as far as warding and positioning goes. Kramer even going to go back and buy himself his next item. Might look for a lifesteal item here, might just want the Last Whisper as a bit of future-proofing. But so many strong carries, and now tanks as well actually on either side. Stake just finished that Random One's Omen.
I actually wonder what Double Lift's going to build here, if he's going to go for the early Last Whisper for damage efficiency, or if he just values his just being able to stay alive in this fight a little more. Bloodthirster is a distinct possibility coming out here. He needs at least some lifesteal here to really, really even make that health that he gets from Wu even more valuable, because he stays alive, regens up again, and it's becoming increasingly harder to kill him, because if he stays alive, he's really the driving force for CLG in these teamfights.
Well, Double Lift can answer your question. Crepo, it is the Last Whisper. Actually had a lot of money banked up. So able to take that away. Even Pobelter with an extra needlessly large rod, as these teams have gone from two items to two and a half or more very swiftly. Deadman's Plate also completed for Zion. So both teams still scaling up.
Yeah, so Double Lift has a lot of faith in the face of the mountain shield coming out of Aframu, and then just the shields coming out of Pobelter here. Hopefully his faith is rewarded.
Well, if he's the most important member of CLG, I hope his team can protect him. Nice dodge. Double Lift out of that Winter's Bite. He's going in. This is full on Jugger Jinx mode as he's just firing away.
All right, let's see how this push for vision does work. CLG right now, what they're trying to do is up their ward line.
Ooh,
and Double Lift gets some crits on Sword Art.
Oh, doesn't get the snipe though. Zap will get dodged as a Glacial Fissure was burned.
Yep, Sword Art's got to be very careful. Everybody's watching for the rocket to come through here.
And that is,
Double Lift keeps it.
That is so big in terms of tempo. Not only does Sword Art has to expend his flash and ultimate, he also has to base. That is one of your main warders, since there's only there's a side zone on Skarsa, but he can't really aggressively move in here. CLG have retaken complete control. And they learned from their mistake. They're getting vision even deeper into the enemy jungle. And now Flash Wolves have to face like a set of brushes. Pobelter going in.
Yep, flash out from Pobelter. Zion going to go in, but Stake looks for the scoop. He gets two, but Double Lift going to keep firing. Afro headbutt Stake out, but that might actually be the best spot. Maple going to get stunned up by a cocoon as, again, these fights so close to starting.
Oh, they're looking for a re-engage here. Oh, nice slow there to take the Dead Man's Plate bonus movement speed off of Zion Spartan.
CLG might just look for a siege instead. Double Lift very far forward. Gonna fire into that turret. Afro looking for a dive. Maple out with the slow though as Afro gets stunned by Braum. Double still firing as Afro's forced to pop that ulti. And he's going absolutely nuts.
Sword Art was able to keep the turret upright though. But
oh my god, the crit! Double Lift gets the first kill. But he does get taken out here. And now Flash Wolves will keep fighting. Maple managed to scoop in as the dual lane is dead from CLG.
Paid for that crit with his life.
He's like, guys, I got the re. Oh, I'm dead.
He was excited, yes, but nowhere to go from there. Does mean that Flash Wolves will have priority on Dragon here. They've got the vision, and they have their jungler as well.
Should have bought a Bloodthirster.
Come on.
This is 2020 hindsight. Overall, yeah, good re-engaging from Flash Wolves. They're really good at going into the fights and going backwards.
Face of the Mountain still on cooldown, but...
Uh-oh.
Yeah, he had Fade, but it wasn't there. He actually has heal still available too, so let's watch that again here.
Right.
Tower almost going down here, so let's see. Maple gets caught, combo lands, but Maple with that Zonyas and that ulti, so much zone. You really don't want to stack on top of him, and Kramer is dealing a lot of damage to Aphro.
Alright, so let's take a look at this here from Double Lift. Yeah, they were able to save the turret. Here comes his crit. He got one, and the ultimate was channeled, but Maple just blows him up. Yeah.
He also tanks the ulti and then uses his own ultimate to get out of there. So Maple takes one for the team. 2-for-1 trade there for Flash Wolves.
There's a reason that Maple's so talked about. Oh, here we go. Karsa's going to have to get out. Yeah, he went for the second item. Titanic.
Hydra
here.
Yep.
Which is... Yeah, people have a lot of differing views on it right now. I'm not quite as big a fan, but on Rek'Sai it does feel pretty good, just because the reset actually works very cleanly with her. Some champions it works better than others.
But yeah, this is turning Karsa into, yeah, he starts off as a tank, but he's becoming more of a damage threat. And suddenly if you look at Flash Wolves, whereas initially we looked at, yeah, Stake and Karsa gonna get very, very tanky. Both of them are getting, or becoming damage threat. So we see four carries emerge in front of Flash Wolves. It's gonna be hard to play against four CLG.
That is true. He does sacrifice a lot of tankiness.
Yeah.
He hasn't built any armor with this build.
No Aegis yet.
And Double Lift can just rip through that health. This is very easy, even though you have a lot of health. It just makes any little bit of armor that you would buy on top of that even more efficient.
Yeah, and look at Sword Art. He's actually starting to build an Aegis, so he has the burden of the Aegis, so he can never even get Zeke. So later on, Kramer may run into some damage problems really later in the fight, because if Aphro goes for that item, obviously big damage swings in terms of AD carries, and at one point they will 1v1 each other in the fight.
Yeah, and just to note, in that last replay, Flash Wolves did get their third dragon as well, so that's starting to mount up as a win condition for the team. 31 and a half minutes in almost, and once again, dragon is down. We are back to dancing around the Baron, but neither team has managed to find an edge yet.
But yeah, CLG did the right thing with that Baron pitch. It is not enough to have only vision around the Baron pit. You really want it deeper into the jungle so you can force basically multiple layers of face check. People have to be afraid to face check four brushes in a row, because if they take the hesitant path and face check them slowly one by one, that's the time it takes for you to take Baron. And then obviously it becomes incredibly hard to play against that. So that's what CLG wants to get right now, and Flash Wolves, they want to stop that from happening.
And Karsa actually burns the ulti to make sure that happens as well. Aphro trying to peek around for a player's Double Lift will shove out the top turret. But Stake is ready with that TP. Have to be careful.
Both top laners are ready.
Ooh, Karsa's swoops in there into X. Mithy Brom Stun will land there. The damage is out, but the Chompers will zone them away.
Maple
looking to dive in. Goes aggro onto Double Lift. Finds himself the stun. Sion off the other side. Does go down to Karsa. And now they're going to swoop in onto Aphro. No ulti left for the Alistaris. He will die as well.
Yeah, because Double Lift was stunned there by Maple, that bomb flash was a time to tear through the front line, get two kills. And I was going to get incredibly hard for CLG to stop this Baron.
That was a huge pick right there. Karsa going in onto Smithy and chunking him low. It meant that they could collapse on the teleport from Zion, and it looks like they're going to grab Baron here.
Double Lift maybe look for a steal here with the ultimate, but that's about all he can. Doesn't land it. Kramer able to secure it, and the Flash Wolves finally get the first big lead in this game.
Yeah, Maple doing exactly what is expected of an assassin. Come in at the flank, keep them busy. Either you kill somebody one for one, or you keep multiple members busy and you back out. This is what Ekko is so fantastically good at in the mid lane. He goes in, has Zonyas, pops ulti back out, and in that time frame, Zion Spartan melted and Aphromu, yeah, he was caught with a break. With his ultimate, he's still gonna go down.
The coordination there on Flash Wolves, definitely superior here. So there goes Karsa, able to get Smithy, and they burn him down so much, there's really no threat here, and they can easily collapse. As you said, Maple locks up the entire back line, and then just ults out.
Yep,
this is peace. And like you mentioned, Aphro, ulti or not, isn't going to live through all that many members. So the question now, what can Flash Wolves do with this lead? It's not that massive gold wise, but Baron is a huge objective for momentum and really trying to snowball the game.
I mean, CLG, when they're defending their towers, they're not going to be stuck in choke points like they were. That this probably was one of the worst fights spots to fight rather for CLG because the way Flashwells came in, Karsa came in from her flank over a wall, Maple came in from that same flank in a choke point, then your parallel conversions is just so good at zoning. Either they walk into it and get stunned, or they can't even enter the fight, so really a good team fight either by Flashwells.
Yeah, CLG cannot afford for one of their backline members to get flanked again.
See, Flashwells starting to again press their advantage a bit more. They've got dragons coming up. We have number four for the team back in a minute 20. The Flashwells, though, gonna just shove down mid lane any way they can.
And Stake ended his Hunger Strike. As Yamato Cannon said it, he now finished Thornmail. So he starts off as this split pusher DPS, but then he becomes an unkillable tank. And again, he's like hybrid damage step and tank, but it's incredibly hard to focus him down with that Thornmail. One tower falls, two towers fall. Combo comes in.
Yeah, Afro looking for it, but he gets stunned up. The tower will fall. Ulti up from Rome's gonna zone them away. Karsa gonna try and dive back in, but Zion able to keep them out. Maple can't quite find his way through, but they're just gonna keep going. Flash rolls, it's all brute force right now.
Double F trying to chase them off.
Look at that ghost trailing though. Maple's ready to go back in.
Yeah, Double wants it. Does get the slow into Sword Art. Frame going to take the Raptors on the exit out here. They know Dragon's up soon. They want to be in position for it.
Ooh, can't. Maple might ultimate use his Echo ultimate.
Let's do it.
So they've used not only his ultimate, but also the Rek'Sai ultimate. Everybody keeping up the siege. And Zion,
yeah,
the turret's going down.
Caught out now. Zion actually just dead as the turret falls as well. No, he will live for just a bit longer, but the Baron up minions will select it. Now Maple pumps his on, dodging that cocoon. Sword Art on the backline is going to die. Double Lift is firing away. Stake is low now up to the status. He's forced to flash. Pobelta snipes in with a glitter lance just off the edge. And CLG, they'll keep running. Pobelta does get it again. Picks up the double.
Scratch that, Pobelta, most important player on CLG here. He's able to get the double kill for themselves, and Double Lift, thinking about face checking, able to get the choppers down first.
If those traps were any farther in that brush, they would have connected here on Crypt. Good move by CLG, they thwart the pressure, they realized, or perhaps not even realized, that the ulti was used on Echo, and that honestly was a very greedy move here by Maple, because he really needed that ulti to get back out of the fight. Once CLG gets one kill, the resets come in, Pobelta picks up two, and most importantly, they get the dragon.
Yep, denying that fourth dragon and kind of relinquishing the threat of the fifth for a bit longer is important here for CLG, but it has been a scrappy game as we are going to have a replay.
All right, so here goes the tower dive. It actually had only two hits left on it for Kramer there. He's able to take it out. So much used on Zion, though. Maple went all in. There's the exhaust.
Exhaust comes out. Maple, he's now stuck, so he has to get out. He can't even go aggressively anymore. Stake has to disengage. And in this position, Flashwells have a very hard time winning the fight. If Maple had ulti, yeah, he could zone, but Double Lift, so much damage. Pull out the flashes aggressively. Right. Target the Krugs on your way out, and good move. We see Karsa here. Who's fighting whom?
I don't know. Ulti is not going to connect. Sword Art blocks it. Karsa flashes. Does not want to get caught. CLG almost find themselves a pick. Double Lift starting to get crazy strong.
Yeah, Aphromoo actually gave him a little bump over closer to safety there. Unfortunate.
It's really hard nowadays, Alistar.
Yeah,
even Aphromoo.
Oh, dead again. Okay. Go, Krempo. You've been having your troubles, I know. I actually had to play on North America from over here in Europe, and I could pull it off, okay? So
yeah,
I don't want to hear your excuses.
I saw that game. You were 0-3 at 10 minutes, dude.
True enough. All right, here, though. Aphromoo going to look to turn his 0-3 around. Looks like he will go for the Zeke. It's going to be a long time coming, though, because he did upgrade his Sightstone first.
I mean, we're looking at the next Baron spawn to really be the match that lights the explosion. That's going to be the big fight here. Both AD carries approaching 4. Double Lift even has a QSS, so that's big. He can deny one of these crowd control effects. So if parallel conversions comes out, he no longer has to be scared to walk into it. He still has to be scared of the damage coming out of Echo, but at least that zoning tool is less efficient, less effective for the Flash Wolves. Let's see if they change their strategy in the fight around that.
And I think we expected maybe a closer game here, and that's what we've gotten here, but a longer game as well. 10 minutes more on average than the long games currently at Worlds so far. But you can tell Flashwolves still trying to push things down. Double had to recall. He's way out of position.
Again, Sword Out, able to protect the minion wave, blocks the wave clear. They even have the Banner of Command here, with CLG reinforcements come down, and they're able to clear it out. Big wave top as well that they were able to pressure.
Yeah, Banner not used for split push. Very inefficient if you just use it straight in the lane. Very easy to kill. Obviously, if you have Baron buff, then Baron becomes really good. But before that, you need to use it in the side lane.
Instead, now it's CLG that are going to try and tear down the mid lane. Both teams, again, have really looked for a big 5v5, but no openings really except for that Baron from the Flash Wolves.
Yeah, I mean, after that one really good pick there from Flash Wolves on the top side, they got a huge chunk, pretty much all this gold lead, but there's so much standing gold.
Oh my god, he's completely dead! Nice combo from CLG, and they'll keep running down. Sword Art getting crit. CLG find the opening they needed.
Yeah, we may call them the no flash rules. Their flash on cooldown on four of the members. AD carry drop. This mid lane tower is under siege. Baron spawning in mid. This could be the game winning opening for CLG.
Huge play there from Zion. I don't even know how Kramer got in that position, but CLG are going to take it and they're going to run with it straight up the gut.
And it costs you so much when you make mistakes this late into a game. But CLG will finally crack an inhibitor as the mid lane one does fall down.
That is an expensive mistake. Or CLG, they could straight up run for Baron too if they want to. They don't really seem to want to go for 50-50.
Oh, good play there. Gets the combo of a Maple. Comes his way back in. He wants double. He pops his on his stack. He's deep into the back lines there, but he can't get the ulti. Big scoop there. Finds on a four, but CLG, they are still fighting. Stake's going to get dusted by Zion Spartan, and he will live through it as well.
Flash Wolves held them to one kill after that reinitiation, though, and CLG have lost control of the map now because Zion has to go back and heal. He does have teleport, though, so actually they're going to set down ward coverage around Baron first. Zion going back to heal right now and teleport back in. He could go for a flank. There is no stake.
And he still has ultimate because he's above level 16 at that point, using
that ward,
ultimate gets reset. One ward! There's wards on the map!
There's so many wards they can teleport in with Zion. He has home guards as well. They're trying to bait them in here. 25 seconds left on stage.
The CLG special Baron has been started though. Zion teleporting in. He's gonna look for a flank and CLG are gonna unleash. Maple has been caught. He's gonna 1v1 the Darius and Zion more than happy to try and fight the wolves. They are fleeing. Zion will flash in and a Buster Shot's gonna disengage. Now Pobels are gonna chase. They need one kill. Afro misses the Pulverize and CLG are still fighting. Ulti will get flashed away.
Back. He's spawned.
Now Kasa gets struck. Kramer. Oh, misses the last crit there. Now Kasa getting down as the shutdown will happen. Now Sword Art. He's going to get chased down. CLG, they need a little bit more. There's Elise with the double. And they're just going off. The late game team fighting so strong.
What a comeback for CLG there. They're able to bait it. And that's going to turn into at least two inhibitors. 40 seconds left on two members. They can even pressure for more.
Yeah, they're 5v3 right here. Stake has to really make some fancy move. Kramer's busy wave clear. CLG looking at Nexus Towers.
Yeah, they're gonna try for it. Maple gets grabbed up. Combo lands in. Stake looks for it. Huge scoop back. Double gets stunned. Kramer gets the first kill onto Afro and Zion has to run out. He's so tanky with the help, but Kramer gets cocooned. He'll get shut down, but Elise has gone down. It's just so crazy.
Double lift is still up though. They can go straight for Nexus turrets. They have minions. Stake can't get back in time.
No, we can't now. They are gonna try and knock it down. One turret for CLG. Getting in a crazy game. They're gonna try and knock it down. They are behind in gold as they take out the Nexus, but CLG will win the game.
What a comeback right there for CLG. Able to leverage a single pick into pick after pick, controlling the vision, saving that teleport and coming in for the home guard.
On the ward!
On the ward right there. Well, I saw it coming! but it was a huge comeback, and this was such a close game. This is honestly what we were expecting from this matchup between Flash Wolves and CLG. Neither team disappointed. Stake was able to have a really good comeback from that early stages of the game, and Flash Wolves, honestly, played really well up until the end stages.
Yeah, but in the last 3 minutes or so, Flash Wolves only had 20 seconds with all five members alive. CLG managed to find one pick, back off one more pick, kill somebody. Yeah, it wasn't clean. Some combos were missed, but it doesn't matter. Relentless aggression coming out of the CLG there, and eventually, Flash Wolves, they re-engaged. They got a little overconfident once they got some damage down, and yeah, once that cocoon from McSmith connected on Kramer, again, really big. They subbed out their AD carry, putting Kramer instead, and he got caught a couple of times over the game.
Yeah, we never got to see the replay. I'm not exactly sure. Smithy probably just came up with
he cocooned him.
Max range. Yeah,
yeah. Kramer walked into it. Flash Wolves got overconfident once they traded some damage efficiently. CLG committed to killing Maple, but obviously he is AP Echo. Once the ulti is out, he came back in full HP, and suddenly Flash Wolves felt like they could win the fight. But then their AD carry walked into a well-placed cocoon by Smithy, and that was really the game turner.
What was honestly impressive was the decisive way with which CLG took that small advantage and were able to turn it into so much more for the team. They had to take that opening.
Yeah, and this game felt incredibly, you know, action-packed, but the end score was only 10 kills on each side. So if you, it doesn't feel to me that this game was only 10 kills, because there were so many re-engages, peeling, combos, saving each other, sword art, fantastic bomb performance, showing why this is probably the best support pick you can get here. Alistar close second, but obviously much harder to pull off and just less, yeah, tools in your kit.
Yeah, I mean, there were so many good things for Flash Wolves that they showed. They had flanks from Karsa, from Maple. Stake was able to get some decent engages as well for the team.
I think in general, both teams just showed so much here. It's no surprise that at the World Championships, we did have a couple of maybe one-sided games here and there, but the longest game we've had, almost 42 minutes, and we saw so much from both these teams.
Yeah, and going back to the pregame, we talked about how Paul Welter was under pressure from not only Mabel, but also Karsa. He ended the game 3-0-7. That he's involved in every single kill that CLG produced while giving up no deaths at all. He farmed well, he did his job protecting Doublelift, even sniped a couple of kills here and there. So he didn't crumble, and that was he was the rock CLG needed to lean on, so he did fantastic well.
If Pobelter didn't get those kills, nobody was gonna get him.
Yeah. Snapped him.
Doublelift unfortunately cannot get all the kills, but a nail-biting game for both teams. We expected it to be close here, as those are some signs out in the audience. Doublelifts everywhere, apparently. Back at the analyst desk, out in the crowd. Paris, you've been a whole lot of fun, just like that game was. And again, we expected it to be close. CLG win a very important game in dramatic fashion.
Yeah, and then up next, we've got the rest of this group playing out. Koo and Pain going to go to head-to-head really shortly here. That one's going to be exciting. They, as you said, we're both going to be watching this previous game that we just cast.
So I don't know if Koo is going to be happy with this, because both teams played relatively close in each other's level, and Koo actually has the tools to beat these type of games that get slow starts, long drawn out, because they're a fantastic mid-game team. At the same time, there were some really good fights from both these teams here, so definitely will be interesting to see how that plays out, and also, you know, what Monte Cristo has out of an opinion of Koo here. Obviously, coming in supreme, the Korean overlords ready to destroy a former team here on CLG, so a lot of good narratives.
This game definitely was a very mixed bag with positive and negatives on both sides.
Yeah. I mean, you can see the interview being prepped there as well. So not too much longer, as I believe we'll be joined by Aframu from CLG in just a sec. But I feel like both teams had to use almost every weapon they had to kind of get to that point in the game, and CLG showing that it's not just good early game and good laning, but excellent late game team fighting. The trust that they've built, the synergy they've built really shows.
I think you can learn a lot from this early game overall, because the way CLG, they faked the lane swap kind of, they said, hey, we're going into this lane swap, dividing the map in half, then they really late invaded to the Crux, and then the entire Stake narrative happened out, but I think Shox is ready, so.
She certainly is. Let's throw it down to Shox in interview land for a word with CLG's Rush Hour bottom lane.
Thank you, guys. I am here with the Rush Hour bottom lane, Aframu and Doublelift, after winning over the Flash Wolves. Now, when you guys walked on the stage, I said, whew, that was close. And you guys immediately went, no, it wasn't. So care to elaborate? Because it looked close to me, Doublelift.
Yeah, go ahead, Peter.
I was joking.
Okay.
That was a really close game. I think we ended it, and the score was still 10-10.
Yeah.
So we were losing for most of the game.
So especially in that early game, which you guys are usually quite good at, so what do you think you guys could have done better to react to the Flash Wolves in the early game?
I think it was a little bit of miscommunication on where Rek'Sai was, and we had an unfortunate mishap there. So our game plan started to falter because of that. So it happens, but we've shown that we can come back with the deficit.
Yeah, you can. So that's also a good lesson to learn here in the first game. Tell me, though, what happens then in your mind, because you have a favorable draw, as everyone says, for your group. You have the faith. You are coming out of NA as the first seed, and then you end up in a game like this. Does your mind start to wonder, Doublelift?
Actually, I was really confident the whole game because we were just completely destroying them bot lane. I think at some point I was like 100 CS up, so I knew that even though we were behind as a team, we have a really good team comp. Like Lulu Jinx is just extremely strong mid-late game, and we pulled it through.
Do you feel maybe his cardboard cutout would have done better, or was it fine as it was?
Oh, no. I love the real thing.
Well, fantastic start here for you guys. As you've seen some of the games here and the meta and the way you've played in this game, we know that you guys are super confident. We've heard that in the interviews coming into this tournament. Can you elaborate a little bit where that comes from? And Doublelift, we know you're always confident, but it's a different thing to say we have what it takes to win the whole thing.
Yeah, you go first, Ben.
Oh, well, it's for you, man.
All right. Well, I don't know. I'm always confident, because if you go in with like a loser's mentality, like, oh, we might not win, then I've had that happen to me before in my career, and it's really not good. Like, for your team mentality, and also just like how much effort you're putting in to the game. I want to make sure that we're all like 100% focused in the game. So I don't know, I just feel like this is the best roster I've ever played with. And it just goes to show Zion can have a bad game, and in the end, we can just pick it up.
Finally, Aframu, anything to add to that?
No.
No?
No.
In unison, that's how it's supposed to be. Well, congratulations. Thank you guys very much, Doublelift and Aframu. And as for us, we're going to break down the game a bit further over at the desk.
Thank you, Shaq. You know, I, for one, would like to get the Thorn head and the Doublelift cutout out here and let them discuss how the game went. All of that aside, let's just start from the beginning. As this was actually, of course, we have one of our longer games right after we talk about how quick the tournament has been going. But I think a lot of that can be lent to, you know, starting with champion select. Let's look at the teams that, that they drafted and how they played out.
Well, of course, if you see Elise and Lulu in the same team, you start to question, like, the pick and ban. Like, sure, if you think that you're going to play Azir into it, it might be fine, but they pick the Echo into it. You pick an Assassin into Lulu, then you're just bound to lose. And I think that was what carried CLG in this game, because they played not so good.
Yeah, they really didn't play that well. And if we talk about, they got the Darius too in the last round of the draft on the blue side. So they ended up with this just insanely strong team composition for this patch. And Flash Wolves, they don't really have a form of primary engage on this team. They have to flash Gnar ult. They have to do something, because as long as CLG just groups at a turret, Lulu whimsies the Jinx, you can get the autos off on the turret, and the siege is virtually unstoppable if you have deep wards. And I think we'll get around to talking about that a little bit more in a
minute. So we saw all these incredibly high-priority picks fall onto the side of CLG, and yet Crumbs, for a period of time, it seemed relatively even.
I'm heartbroken, shattered even. I didn't know you could find games like these when you go dumpster diving. Like, I felt really bad watching this, because for a team that's claiming that they can be the best team in the world, this is far from it. You are not allowed to have games like these if you're actually wanting to get first place. Like, they only won solely because of the draft. Just because Flash Wolves did not have an engage and had a couple of misplays with picks here and there was the only reason that...
Specific negatives that jumped out at you.
From Flash Wolves, the composition not being able to draft properly, getting picked off in random locations for CLG, not utilizing the strength of the team composition. For example, the sieging, they put a lot of pressure into taking mid lane turret, but then eventually they just like, no, we're not going to do that anymore. Even
now,
though
I'll
was
let you
working.
Take over there.
I'm about to unleash this one. We can talk about the dragon control too from CLG. Now we know that Flash Wolves is a much more dragon focused team, but a lot of this was prompted by Xmithie's very awkward recall timings. He sits on a huge amount of gold and it leaves, so they can't fight because he has no items, and then he recalls, and they just took the first dragon. So there were a lot of opportunities that Flash Wolves made use of, because Xmithie doesn't really know when he needs to go back and buy, and he sits on just this mountain of money that's doing nothing. Now, if we talk about CLG's early advantages, even though they were having a hard time in that top lane, they just need to group and siege. But to group and siege on the tier twos, they have to start getting deep wards. CLG's vision control that game was very, very, very poor. But if you get the wards in, they can't teleport on you. Notice that Stake didn't buy home guards forever in that game, even though they didn't have a form of engage. So you couldn't even get the teleport in on that from a flank or anything. But CLG, they need to group up. They were way too focused on the Baron. This is not a composition that you go for the Baron for. They had split calls coming off the Baron. I mean, it was a disaster of a game, really. I think they are fortunate to have won.
Now, I want to look at takeaways specifically when we look at the rest of the group. As we said, this group A here is one of the ones that, you know, can really have some surprises in it. You look at these two teams, some were putting CLG ahead of KOO, but, you know, I'm sensing from the desk here that this is not necessarily a team that we're looking can beat out KOO later in the group
stages. After this game, I'm sure KOO Tigers did a little dance. You know, they were happy after this game. But it's like, if I think about the future of the group, these draft mistakes are simple to fix for UA Flash Wolves. But these like mid-game mistakes that you were talking about is so hard to fix within like a week. So I'm worried for TOG.
It is a draft mistake, but you can play around it. Like they have many of opportunities. For example, the delayed siege from CLG that eventually got countered by some wonky TP that was like in front of CLG, where they simply walked away without home guards even. So if they actually correct the mistake of using the teleport, but that's what we were talking about, Stake, you know, not being an underwhelming top laner. But I think that we can learn that he is receiving a lot more flack than he should.
Yeah, like, for sure.
He played a lot better than we were expecting. Dodged those three ganks very well and held his own in the top lane.
Final words?
Yeah, I have to agree with Yamato. If I'm Ku, and I know my strengths as the Ku Tigers, which are, as the casters alluded to, playing a very clean, objective-based mid-game. They know how to run their compositions so well. Their problem is in the laning phase. But we see CLG start to bully the lane, start to accrue CS leads, and then just bumble around the map, which is exactly what we saw in their win against TSM, too. So I think this is very concerning for CLG. They haven't fixed it, at least from what we saw today. And they had 3 weeks off. And Ku, this is their strength. Their strength is going to be playing the mid game well. And I don't really see how CLG is going to outplay them in that phase.
Well, we get an opportunity to see their groupmates play in our next game of the day. We do have to take a break real quick. But when we come back, Brazil's Pain Gaming will face off against Korea's Ku Tigers. Don't touch that browser.
If I got you, baby.
Damn, our harmony sucks, guys.
That's our team synergy right now, guys.
Keep the turret upright, though.
Oh, my God! The crit sample gets the first kill, but he does get taken out here.
Narnar, look up,
I got him. I got him. I'm going to chase.
I'm slowed.
I slowed myself.
Careful. All right. Hey, we're pushing. I'm pushing.
I got Echo.
Okay.
Nice. Oh, Echo! Good play there. Gets the combo of a Maple. Stabbed his way back in. He wants double. He pops his only stack. He's deep into the back lines here, but he can't get the ulti. Has to run out. He's so tanky with the help of Kramer. Gets cocooned. He'll get shut down, but at least that's gone down. CLG will win the game.